Good morning to all of you. We will discuss today the second topic in second module, the factor wheel, GCD, Fibonacci, Tower of Henry and Ackerman function, which are basically recursive functions, where the problem is going to be simplified to its smaller version. So these are the four classical versions that generally will be discussed as a part of recursion. So before that, just to briefly sum up what we discussed in previous class. We discussed in previous class what is a stack and where the stack is going to be useful, what kind of operations that a stack is going to undergo, like push, pop, peek, is full, is empty, etc., and the abstract data type for a stack and its applications, particularly to the Polish notations, infix, prefix and postfix notations and their respective conversions, how do you convert from one form of the Polish notation into the other form of Polish notation. So in the previous class we clearly understood the infix to postfix conversion using the stack. Also, how do we do for a particular example of this kind, and followed by how do we evaluate an infix expression using the stack, that we discussed in the previous class. Like this, how do we use the stack for postfix evaluation, also we discussed in the previous class, where one stack will be used for infix, and whereas in the other case the postfix will be used in the two stacks. Also, how do we convert infix to postfix prefix conversion? These topics were discussed in previous class, and we will resume the discussion on the recursion. So what basically a recursion is? A recursion is a programming technique that solves a problem by solving a smaller version of its own, a smaller problem of the same type. So when you turn this into a program, you will be ending up with function where it is going to call by itself. So generally the recursive function refers to a function which calls itself, either directly or indirectly. For example, here we consider the most classical example for recursion is the factorial. Factorial can be either recursive or non-recursive in nature. So here if it is going to be n equal to 0, so in the sense like we need to define where this function is going to end up when it is going to call by itself. At some point of time it has to terminate. We call such termination condition as base case. So here if it is not the base case, we are going to simplify the problem into a smaller version of its own. So here what fact basically factorial is, if you want to find out a factorial of 4, then you are going to result it as 4 into 3 into 2 into 1. If it is factorial of n, then it will be n into n minus 1 into so and so into 3 into 2 into 1. So here if you are going to pass it as 4, then because 4 is not equal to 0, then it will be returning it as 4 into, it is going to be another function call. So what this function will call into is, it will again call with a value of 3, and again it will call with a value of 2, etc. So basically it is going to decompose a task into smaller subtasks, where the subtask and base task will be having some sort of similarity. At least one subtask must be having some sort of similarity. So here when I call 5 factorial, it will call 5 into 4 factorial. So 4 factorial, if I am going to call, it will call it as 4 into 3 factorial, etc. And it will return back, because once it reaches the terminal condition or the base condition, it will return back. So it cannot go beyond 1 and 0. So it will return back as, so 0 factorial is 1, so it will return as 1 into 1 is 1, 2 into 1 is 2, and 3 into 2 as 6, 6 into 4 as 24, 24 into 5 as 120, and the final value that is going to be returned is the 120. Factorial of 5 is 5 into 4 into 3 into 1 is 120. So If you are not following the recursion, then this is going to be the iterative version. Within a for loop, we define the base condition with an initialization value, and within the for loop, we keep on multiplying all the respective values up until the value of n. So then we return the value if it is going to be recursion. Then you might wonder how to write the recursive functions. So recursion is applicable only for those problems where you can decompose the problem into a smaller version of the same kind. So that you need to keep in mind. So determine the size factor. So before you write, you need to understand what is the size factor, because when a function is going to be called again and again, the system stack must be capable of handling it. So that is why you must determine the size factor, determine the base case when the recursion is going to terminate, and also after estimating the base case or the terminal case, you must understand how to generalize it. Like it should not be only for a limited set of values, it should be generalized case. So if it is a generalized case, whether it is going to be working for all possible values routinely, or it is going to be only applicable in the best case for the best case or the worst case, etc. So recursive call to the function involve a smaller case of the original problem, leading to inspecability of the base case. So you need to be thorough with these three aspects. One is the size factor, and the other one is the base case, and the other one is the general case. Once you determine these three factors, then you need to verify the algorithm whether it is going to be applicable for all possible values or not. So the types of recursion. So there are two types of recursion. One is the direct recursion, where the function is going to call itself. The other kind is the indirect recursion, where the function calls some other function, and some other call function the original function. So likewise, it is going to be keeping on within the recursive calls. Num will call sum and sum will call num, but ultimately it must reach to the base condition either in the first function or in the intermediate functions. So once it reaches to the base condition or the terminal condition, it must come out. So here, if it is indirect recursion, the programmer must take care of when it is going to terminate. So first you need to understand also the base condition. Is there any non-recursive way of solving the problem? What do you mean by that is, first, is there any non-recursive way or the iterative way, and does that routine work properly? So that basic elementary thing, basic elementary value that the base case is going to be. And the smaller question will be, does each recursive call to the function involve a smaller case of the original problem, leading to a base case? And the general case will be, assuming that recursive calls work correctly as a whole function for irrespective of whatever the value that you are going to feed. So these things you must keep in mind when you are going to whether it is going to be a direct recursion or indirect recursion. So another possible question that you need to answer is, when I can solve it with iteration, why I need to prefer the recursion? So that you need to understand. So iteration can be used in place of recursion, because iteration uses only the looping construct, any while loop or do while or a for loop, whereas in the recursive algorithm it uses the branching structure, which enormously increases the space and the time complexity. So recursive solutions are often less efficient in terms of both the time and space than iterative solutions, but it makes the program very simplified version. It gives the most simplified and shorter version of the iterative version of the program. That is why usually the recursion is going to be chosen. For example, you consider the application of recursion to the GCD. GCD stands for the greatest common divisor of the two values A and B. So the base conditions will be, if either of A, if B equal to 0 or A equal to 0, then in that case appropriately the A and B will be returned as the value of the GCD. If not, if either the value, if both are positive integers, then in that case is again it is going to be a recursive call where the first parameter will be a mod b and the second parameter will be b. If a is less than b, then it is going to be vice versa. The first parameter will be a and the second parameter will be b mod a. For example, you consider the GCD of 7854 and 3108. So how do I express 7854 is it is going to be 1 into 4746 and plus 3108. So how do I express again the remainder 4746 is it is going to be, now it is in between 4746 and 3108. So it is going to be expressed as 1 into 3108 plus the remainder 1638. So now it is going to be in between 1638 and 3108. So how do I express this 3108 is, because it is going to be the remainder, so I express it as 1 into 1638 plus. So likewise, if I keep on calculating, I end up with ultimately the right one as 0. So the moment I encounter it as 0, then I must conclude that 42 is going to be my GCD. So that is what the recursive call is. This is going to be a recursive, direct recursive call, which is going to be implemented for the GCD. So before we proceed further to the other example, we take a look at the program, how it works, the GCD. So when you go to the GCD function here, so GCD is a function. So let me switch over to the so here the main function is available, and GCD here, what is GCD is, GCD here we are going to consider only one value, x modulus y equal to 0. This is the base condition that it is going to reach, and we consider all only one kind, GCD of y comma x percentage y. If you want to consider the other case also, where you have the y is going to be less than, then in that case it must be x y percentage x comma y, if you want to consider the other condition. But here in this programming example, we consider that always x is going to be less than y. So when you run this program, this is basically formulated by one scientist called as the Euclid. So when you run this program, what you get is, say I will enter it as 24 and 36. So the GCD of 24 and 36 is the 12. So that is what we get through the recursive calls. So we switch back to the here you don't observe in this example there is no branching here, but actually there will be a kind of thing called as the branching that happens here. So in this example, if you consider, there are two versions here which have been listed out here. One is recursive Fibonacci and the other one is the normal Fibonacci, where you simply write out without any sort of recursion here using the for loop. So if you want to determine the value at say 5th, then I need to obtain the element at the 4th position and the element at the 3rd position. I will sum up and I will get the element at the 5th position. Similarly, for up until the nth value, we are going to keep on doing the same process if it is an iterative. But if it is going to be recursive, then in that case the base conditions are going to be, if it is the very first position or the second position, then you return appropriately as 0 and 1. Otherwise, what you return is the fib of num of 1, num minus 1, num minus 2, the previous two elements. So what basically a Fibonacci series is, so here 0 is going to be the very first position, 1 is going to be at the second position, and then how do you get this one is 0 plus 1. How do you get this 2 is 1 plus 1. How do you get this 3 is 2 plus 1. So how do you get this 21 is 13 plus 8. So the previous two elements sum is going to be the next element value. So that is how you are going to calculate it as. So if you want to understand the recursion in terms of, say, branching, as earlier I told, Fibonacci fibonacci of 4 if you are going to call it as, then fibonacci of 4 will call fib of 3 and fib of 2. So fibonacci of 3 will call it as again fibonacci of 2 and fibonacci of 1. 2 will call it as fibonacci 1 and 0. 1 will return back, 1 will return back 0 and will return back as 0 and 1 respectively. So when it is going to sum up, when it is going to sum up, and finally fib of 4, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, it is going to return as the 3. So likewise the Fibonacci function is going to be understood. So that can be formulated as the recursive procedure. So when we move on to the next topic, so what is the application of recursion? So one more example is palindrome. So what is a palindrome is, either way you read, either from left to right or from right to left, you are going to get the same string. So how do you ensure that is the element at the very first position must be equal to the element at the last but one position, because in a string the last character will be slash 0. The element at the first position must be equal to the last but one character. So similarly, up until you reach the middle of the string, you keep on comparing the character at the respective positions. So once you feel that they are not matching, they are not equal, then you say it as false, stating that it is not a palindrome. Otherwise, string move to the next position, move to this substring of, you are going to pass it as is palindrome, you are going to pass the substring from where it is substring from the first character to the last but one character. So every time you are going to eliminate out the first character and last character. So likewise last but one character, and pass it on to the same function and find out whether it is reaching the base case. If not reaching the base case, then you find out whether they are equal or not. Depending on that, you keep on working out until you reach the middle of the string or no more elements are present within the given string. So that is another example of the recursion. So another classical example that will be given for the recursion is the what you call the Tower of Hanoi problem. What basically a Tower of Hanoi problem is, there will be three discs, 1, 2, and 3. So these three discs, and there will be n number of there will be three poles, and there will be n number of discs will be there. So in this example, there will be three discs and three poles. So what the Tower of Hanoi problem is going to be posing two conditions. A larger disk must never be stacked onto a smaller one. I'll read it again. A smaller disk must never be stacked above a smaller one. So that always must be followed. And the other condition is, one and only one needle could be used for intermediate. So when I'm going to transfer from here to here, so I can use only this one as a kind of intermediate storage for disk. I cannot use the both the source and destination also as the intermediate storage. I have to transfer n number of disk from this pole to this pole using this as temporary or intermediate storage. That is what the basic funda of the Tower of Hanoi problem. So there are number of ways how you can solve it. So using recursion you can solve it like this. So the different steps that you are going to be involving, if it is going to be consisting of only two disks, then in that case it is very simple. So let rod 1 or the pole 1, rod or pole both means the same, rod 1 have the A, rod 2 have the B, rod 3 have the C. We indicate or we label it like that. Shift first disk from A to B, shift the second disk from A to C, and then the last step will be shift first disk from B to C. That is as simple as possible. But the complexity will be more when if you are going to have more number of disk. If it is going to be only two number of disk, then no problem. But if it is going to be three number of disk, then it increases through seven steps. If it is going to be four, then enormously it is going to increase. The steps that you need to follow is going to increment increase. so we'll go through a program. We'll go through a program to understand how exactly the Tower of Hanai problem will work with as the number of disk is going to be increasing and increasing, then the number of steps are going to be increasing and increasing. Say here I will go through here in the program. It has been specified as number of disk, I will say specify it as 3, and I will run the program. If I run this program, you observe here how many steps that it is going to be. Exactly there will be, say here I am going to be having around half a dozen steps. So if you are going to increase the here, if I increase from 3 to say 4, so when I increase from 3 to 4, how many steps that I need to do is, say I will compile the program again and run it again. So if I go to the the same program, when I run with 4, then you see how many steps that it will generate. So the number of steps are going to be drastically increasing and increasing, which is going to obviously increase the time and space that it is going to be consuming. So that is why the recursive algorithms are going to be, even though they are going to simplify the programming. See, if you consider here it is going to call once and twice, or the same function is going to be called once and twice. The two times the same function is going to be called with intermediate or auxiliary rod to be different in different parameter. So we call that and we try to solve the program. Another example where you find the another classical example called as Ackermann function. Ackermann function is going to be named after Wilhelm Ackermann. He is one of the simplest and earliest discovered examples of the total computable function that is not primitive recursive. All primitive recursive functions are total and computable, but the Ackermann function illustrates that not all total computable functions are going to be primitive and recursive or primitive recursive. So what basically the Ackermann function with two arguments is, so m and n are going to be the parameters that you are going to pass it to, two positive integers that you are going to pass it to the Ackermann function. So the result will be n plus 1 if m equal to 0. If m is greater than 0 and n is equal to 0, then Ackermann function is going to be called again with n minus 1 comma 1. If both are greater than 0, then I will be calling it as a of first parameter will be n minus 1 and second parameter will be the resulting value of a of m comma n minus 1, where m and n are non-negative integers. Negative integers cannot be considered in this case. So that is basically the Ackermann function. So even if you consider only Ackermann function with respect to 2 comma 2 or 1 comma 5, you observe the number of steps that using which it is going to calculate. If it is going to be only 1 and 5, it takes roughly around say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, only in the 12th step it is going to result back, because it is going to be recursive function recalled again and again. So the original use of the Ackermann function was to show that there are functions which are not primitive recursive, that is which cannot be computed by using only for the loops with a predetermined upper limits. So this function cannot be solved with the iterations, but it can be solved with a simplified version of the recursive functions. So So that is about the Ackerman function. So if you go to the Ackerman function, so as it is, we go to the C environment where we try to execute the C program. So in the C program, as earlier it was understood, n is equal to 0. So n is equal to, so here n is equal to 0, and then it is going to return as n plus 1. If it is going to be if it is going to be n plus 1, sorry, n equal to 0, then it is going to return as the n minus 1 comma 1. If else it is going to return as n minus 1 as the first parameter and the second parameter as m comma n minus 1. Yes, it seems earlier I didn't switch back to my slides in the background. I thought I expect you might have understood the things that I have explained. So in the Ackerman function, when you run this program, so when you run the Ackerman function with two parameters as 1 comma 5, so when I run this program, I'll enter it as 1 comma 5, so the output is 7. So the output is going to be the value of 7 that you try to obtain in some 12 or 14 steps. So here the output that you are going to get it as the 7 value, what we computed here. Let me switch back to my presentation slides. Earlier I think I didn't switch back to the, yes, the Ackerman function, when supplied with 1 and 5, I got the result as 7 through the program execution. So that is about the recursion applied to Ackerman function, which basically the purpose of using the Ackerman function is to show that there are functions which are not primitive recursive, that is, which cannot be computed by using only for using the loops with their predetermined and upper limits. And the other function that we discussed was the Tower of Hamel problem. The problem is very simple, but the complexity of the program, either with space or with respect to time, is going to increase with respect to the number of disks, but the number of rods or poles are going to be fixed. Initially all the disks are going to be placed onto one of the pole or rod, and they need to be transferred to the other pole using the sum of using one, only one exactly intermediate or auxiliary pole or rod. And as explained earlier, the recursion is going to be applied to Fibonacciand also applied to GCD, and so it is going to be applied to a factorial function. So this is all about the recursion. But recursion consumes the recursion has got its own problem. So where it the time and even though it simplifies the program, but its time complexity and safe complexity, space complexity will be more. So keeping in mind, you need to understand when to use the recursion and when not to use the recursive functions. In most of the cases, the problem can be solved only with respect to the iteration, then it will be solved. But if it matters with the recursion, then you can use it with. So all the programs that I explained in this session and earlier sessions will be available through my GitHub repository. Please try to execute all the programs in the GitHub repository which was shared earlier with your in your WhatsApp groups. Please try to execute, and also all the lab programs were given through the GitHub repository. Please try to execute all the lab programs also, which are going to be part of theory and as well as lab. If any issues regarding to the lab, please try to report back to me.